Well, we're glad you're here too. We're glad you're in this room with us tonight. We're also glad if you've joined us online, so welcome to everyone. How many of you are ready to study the Bible? Y'all ready? So we're going to continue our series on First Timothy, and I'm speaking on chapter 5 tonight. We're going to study chapter 5. And let me just tell you, this is all the scriptures you're going to need. You can follow in your own Bible if you want, but we're going to read the whole chapter, and we're going to put it up here on the board so that we can kind of just study it together. So I think it's going to be it's going to be an interesting chapter. You know what, before we start, let's pray. Can we do that? Lord, thank you for this evening. Thank you for just life and breath and all you've done for us, Lord. Thank you that, Lord, that you are our Savior, our Lord, you're our provider, you're our shepherd, you're our guide, you're everything that we need, Jesus, and we look to you tonight. You're also our teacher, so we ask you, Holy Spirit, to teach us. Lord, we pray that you'd give us the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that we can know you better. We pray, Father, that the eyes of our hearts would be enlightened by your words and that our hearts would be soft and receptive and obedient to your word. And we would be not only hearers, Father, but we would be doers of the word. And Lord, we just pray that as little children sitting at your feet, that you would just teach us tonight. We, Lord, just want you to speak to our hearts, and we want to be open to you. Pray for every need in this room, Lord, every need, every person that's here in this room, and every need of people that are watching. Lord, I don't know those needs, but you do. You're a good shepherd, and you know the condition of your sheep. So, Lord, whatever they need right now, I pray you would encourage and strengthen and heal and deliver and set free and comfort, whatever they need, Father, I pray that you would show yourself strong on their behalf. Father, we pray that in the name of Jesus, and everybody said, amen. Amen. Well, listen, this is Paul, the older apostle. He's in Rome, and he's awaiting his death. This is his next to last book that he writes before he's executed by Nero in about, I think it's 63 A.D. And he's writing to the young pastor, Timothy, who is the pastor at the church at Ephesus. And he's just encouraging Timothy how to pastor and how to lead well and how to deal with certain situations that have come up in the church there at Ephesus and situations that come up in every church. Well, he was addressing specific situations that were coming up in that church in Ephesus. And this chapter is really pretty straightforward. As I studied it, it's not real hard to understand, and it's very practical. And so I think we can learn something. It's not real, as you would say, exciting, but it's stuff that's in the Bible, I think, that we need to talk about and we need to be aware of. I've divided it into this 7 different categories, and we're going to just go one by one through all 7. The first is that how to treat those in the church or fellow believers. I think most of this is going to be on your outline or either up in on the screen behind me. But how to treat those in the church. And he's obviously talking to Timothy about how to treat the parishioners, but it also applies to us, how we should treat each other as believers. So let's just read the first and second verse there. It's going to be there. Do not rebuke an older man harshly, but exhort him as if he were your father. Treat younger men as brothers, older women as mothers, and younger women as sisters with absolute purity. That's just a great way to look at things, because Paul's saying this: treat older men not harshly, but instead with gentleness and kindness. Honor them like you would honor your own father and treat them like that. And rather than rebuking them harshly, if you have to correct them, instead exhort them and encourage them with gentleness and kindness. You know, I so many times as I was studying this, I had to reflect on our own church. Are we doing this? And that's one thing I can tell you about Joel. That's exactly how Joel ministers. You know, he does it with gentleness and with kindness by exhorting and encouraging us rather than rebuking us or correcting us harshly. And then he says, treat older women as mothers. In other words, respect them and honor them as you would your own mother. Treat younger men that are your age, your peers, as brothers. And then treat younger women as sisters with absolute purity. Everybody say absolute purity. I think that's a really important thing for us in the church to remember. Certainly those of us in leadership, we have to remember that we have to treat all ladies with absolute purity. But I think the practical application that we can take away from those first two verses is this: treat everyone that you meet in the house of God and really outside the house of God, but especially in the house of God, treat everyone with utmost honor and respect and kindness, and encourage them rather than try to rebuke them harshly, as Paul says there. treat women with the utmost purity, and treat everyone as if they were your own family. Amen? So that's just a good start that Paul has to this chapter. Now, the next few verses, I think it's 13 verses, have to do with the subject of widows. And Paul talks a lot about widows in this particular chapter. As a matter of fact, I think it's the bulk of the chapter. So let me contextualize a little bit about how families worked in this particular culture in, you know, the first century A.D. In this time, and particularly in this culture, the family was the central social institution. And what I mean by that, it was a patriarchal society, and everything revolved around the family. Loyalty to one's family was absolutely important. It was one of the essential values that you had. And then these were families or family units that were structured around honor. You honored the patriarch, you honored your mother and your father, you honored older people in the family. And these weren't, you know, in our society we think of a mom and a dad and some children and that's the family unit. Well, that's not the family unit that we're talking about here. It was several generations commonly lived in the same area, in the same home or the home area there. Several generations lived together under one roof. Usually it's the father and the mother, the patriarch and the mother and the children. And then they were often joined by their own grandparents. And then married children, especially sons, would come to live with the father and then bring their wives and they would have their children. So you could have dozens of people in this family unit. And the wife managed the household. She did the cooking and managed the cooking and managed the household and helped raise the children. Obviously, she had help there with the grandparents and all. But the husband was the one that they looked to earn a living, even though sometimes the women did work. But here's the point of this whole cultural context. If the husband died, the extended family would be expected to take care of the widow. It would be the cultural norm in that society that if anybody died, whether you're a believer or not a believer, it's going to be important in a minute, you would take care of the widow. The extended family would take care of them. But if the husband dies and there are no children, or if the children are small, and there's no extended family to help take care of her, it could be very, very difficult for this woman, especially if she was older, because often the elderly could not find work. They may not have enough money or resources or food to live, to survive. There was no social safety net for them. There was nobody to catch them when they were in trouble. And they were in a very desperate and a very vulnerable situation. And apparently in the church at Ephesus, there were apparently quite a few widows in that church. And Paul was instructing Timothy, how do you handle all the widows that are a part of the church of Ephesus? Apparently there was a list, we'll talk about that in a minute, a list of the widows, an official list of the widows that the church was supporting and helping. And there were certain criteria, again we'll talk about in a minute, that these widows had to meet in order to be supported by the church. And some of these widows had apparently made some kind of vow, almost like they said, we're going to live like this. And as a result of that, you take care of us. We're going to live dedicated to God. We're going to live wholeheartedly for God. And we have no thoughts of ever being married again. It's almost like they were making a vow to just have Jesus more or less as their husband and to serve the church and the church family there and the church, the Christian community. This very much reminds me. Do you remember when Jesus was dedicated at eight days of age? Do you remember the prophetess Anna? I think I have this up there. But Anna, listen to what it said about Anna. There was also a prophet Anna. She was very old. She lived with her husband 7 years after marriage. Now, let's just assume she was 13 when she got married. That's very young, I know. But she got married at 13. She lived 7 years with her husband, and then she'd been 84 years a widow. Man, that means she's at least 104 years old. And listen to what the Bible says. It's almost like she had taken this same kind of pledge or this same kind of vow. She never left the temple, but worshiped night and day, fasting and praying, and perhaps even some people in the church took care of her as well. Now, here's one thing I want you to understand. Throughout the Old and New Testaments, widows and orphans and foreigners living among God's people are viewed as special objects of God's mercy. I'll say that again. God has paid special attention to widows, to orphans, and to foreigners, to refugees, to strangers who are new to a land. There are many scriptures. As a matter of fact, I found 76 scriptures just quickly taken account. 76 scriptures that had to do with this particular group of people, widows, orphans, and strangers or refugees or foreigners. I took a couple of scriptures for you to understand how important this is. One is from Deuteronomy 10:18. It's talking about God. God defends the cause of the fatherless and the widow, and He loves the foreigner residing among you, giving them food and clothing. Think about that. God defends the cause of the fatherless and the widow, and He loves the foreigner who resides among you, giving them food and clothing. And then James, now this is several thousand years later, two or 3,000 years later, in the New Testament, James writes these words. Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this, to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. So you see from the very beginning in Deuteronomy to the very end there in James, God cares about orphans, and you know He wants us to care about orphans and widows and to take care of them. So this is exactly what Paul's addressing. So we're going to read the passage now. So this is, starting at verse 3. You can turn that on if you want for me. Verse 3 if you have it. Let's see, one more slide. Can you do it? All right, here we go. Give proper recognition to those widows who are really in need. We'll stop right there. King James says, honor widows who are in need. And another translation is place particular value on widows who are really in need. I think underline that word really, because that's the important part, the ones that are really in need. So honor and recognize and place value on them. I think what God's telling us tonight, at least what He seemed to speak to me, is when you see these people now, when you see widows and people, maybe single-parent moms, or you see people that are struggling, maybe refugees that have come here from different countries, it ought to make us pause. And we ought to say, now, wait a minute. We need to recognize and we need to value these people. Why? Because God recognizes and values them. And so we should too. Goes on to say, if a widow has children or grandchildren, these should learn first to put their religion into practice by caring for their own family, and so that they repay their parents and grandparents, for this is pleasing to God. The widow who is really in need and left all alone puts all her hope in God. Now, this is almost that pledge or vow I was talking about. The widow who is really in need and left all alone with no one to help her, destitute, so to speak, puts all of her hope in God and continues night and day to pray and to ask God for help. But the widow who lives for pleasure is dead even when she lives. Now, what he means by that, lives for pleasure, just lives to serve herself, or lives self-indulgently, or lives extravagantly. The widow that does that, Paul is not commending her. Then he goes on to say this, give the people these instructions so that no one may be open to blame. Now, this is a staggering next verse. Anyone who does not provide for their relatives, and especially for their own households, has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. Think about that. If you don't take care of your own family, men, women, ladies, if we don't take care of our own family, if I'm not helping take care of my mom who's elderly, if I'm not helping take care of my own family, you know what? The Bible says there that I'm worse than an unbeliever. Now, I think one of the ways to understand that is this. The reason that I told you before that if a widow, if a lady loses her husband and she's in an extended family, her extended family, even though they're not believers, would take care of her. Everybody understand that? Well, what if they as believers would not even do what the unbelievers were doing? And so that's what Paul's saying, that if you don't take care of your own family, you're worse than an unbeliever, because an unbeliever, they'll take care of their own family. Let's keep on reading there. No widow, now here he's going to give the criteria of who can be supported as a widow. No widow may be put on the list of widows unless she is over 60, has been faithful to her husband, and is well known for her good deeds, such as bringing up her children, showing hospitality, washing the feet of the Lord's people and helping those who are in trouble and devoting herself to all kinds of good works. So that's the kind of life that the widows should be living if they expected the church to help take care of her. And that's exactly what Paul's saying. He goes on to say, as for younger widows, do not put them on such a list. For when their sensual desires overcome their dedication to Christ, they want to marry. Thus they bring judgment on themselves because they have broken their first pledge. Now let me explain that, because that seemed very hard to me. But as I studied, if you could go back that one more time. It seemed hard to me until I understood that these were probably women that were put on the list. And then they decided, you know what, they weren't going to live that way. They were going to really, they wanted to get married. And so Paul says they just give themselves over to their sensual desires, and they go ahead and get married, and they deny the pledge that they've made. And so that's what Paul's talking about there. Now, in that culture, that worked, but how many of you know now, a widow can get married anytime she wants. I mean, that really doesn't necessarily apply to us now, but supporting widows certainly does. Let's keep reading. Now, he's talking about the widows who don't have anything to do and are not living a godly life. Because besides, they get into the habit of being idle and going about from house to house. And not only do they become idlers, but they also become busybodies who talk nonsense, saying things that they ought not to say. Now, let me just tell you something. Anybody could do that. It's not just women that can do that. Guys, can I have an amen from you guys? So I think the point is, Paul's saying, if you don't have anything to do and you're idle and you really don't have God's interest in your heart, you know, it's easy to go around and just be busybodies and be gossips. And that's not just confined to the female sex. It's also men can do the same thing. Now, then he goes on to say, so I counsel younger widows to go ahead and marry, to have children, to manage their homes and to give the enemy no opportunity for slander. Some, in fact, have already turned away to follow Satan. Now, it's postulated that even some of these Christians may have gotten married, but married people that were not believers and denied their own faith, so to speak. They were led astray by their husbands. So that's one of the things the scholars say. If a woman who is a believer, this is continuing on, if any woman who is a believer has widows in her care, she should continue to help them and not let the church be burdened with them, so that the church can help those widows who are really in need. So if you're a female, you know what, and you have the means and you're taking care of a widow, Paul's saying, let them continue to do that, Timothy, so that the church doesn't have to be burdened with having to take care of somebody that someone else can take care of. Everybody with me? I told you it's not too exciting, but at least it's something that we need to study. Amen? Now, so that's really what it has to do with widows. So here's the practical takeaway is this. Whenever you have anybody in your own family, especially that's a widow, you know what? If they don't have the means to take care of themselves, I know it's a little different now with Social Security and some other things, but if you have a widow in your own family unit, your extended family, and they need help, you need to pray about you being the one to help them, because Paul is encouraging us, God's encouraging us right here to take care of the widows, but also to take care of our own families, you know, to take care of our own families. And then not only widows, I'm going to go ahead and throw in there, let's don't forget the orphans, you know, how about single parent moms that don't have a dad, somebody that needs help, even true orphans. Occasionally you'll see two true orphans in foster care or something like that. You know what? Wherever you see those people, listen, pay particular attention, because God pays particular attention to them. And then also don't forget that the foreigners or the refugees. I don't know if y'all know that, but one of the ministries we have here in missions is that we befriend people that come from other countries. It's very difficult to make that transition. It's very difficult to come from Sudan or Afghanistan or Pakistan and not know the language. And I was very heartbroken recently when I took one of the little girls that didn't speak a word of English to her first day at class with my wife, and just to realize how overwhelming that would be for this little six-year-old who couldn't read anything, couldn't speak the language. Listen, God cares about those people, and so does this church, and we're doing what we can to take care of them. Listen to Matthew 25. When I was sick, you gave me something to eat. When I was hungry, you gave me When I was sick, you cared for me. When I was hungry, you gave me something to eat. When I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. When I was in prison, you visited me. But listen to this last one. When I was a stranger, you invited me in. And that's really refugee care. So, amen. Everybody with me? Now, let's go on to number three. Number three is this. Give utmost respect and honor to those in teaching and preaching and leadership roles in their church. And I can tell you, Lakewood does this as well as any church, I think, on the planet. But give utmost respect to those who are in leadership, especially those who are in preaching and teaching roles. Now, let's read that passage in verse 17. It says this, "The elders who direct the affairs of the church well are worthy of double honor, especially those whose work is preaching and teaching. For the scripture says, 'Do not muzzle an ox while it is treading out grain,' and workers deserve their wages. So there Paul's saying, listen, don't criticize your pastors. Don't make fun of your pastors. Don't belittle them. Don't bring false accusations against them. Don't talk bad about them. Don't spread strife and division. And again, I'm preaching to the choir because that does not happen here because you guys honor. But honor us and Joel and Victoria, everybody who's the pastoral leadership. But one of the reasons I think God blesses this church is because the church treats the pastor that way. And they've done that for years with my mom and dad. So my encouragement to you is this. Just remember, continue to honor your pastor. If you've got something you don't like about him, go talk to him or go talk to somebody about him. But listen, don't spread strife and division and cause conflict. But instead, everything that comes out of your mouth should be something that honors your pastor and the leaders. Amen? What to do? What about when a leader fails? This is point number four. What about when a leader, someone in a leadership position fails? Well, Paul addresses that here with Timothy. He says this. And this is verse 19 and 21. Do not entertain an accusation against an elder unless it is brought by two or three witnesses. But those elders who are sinning, you are to reprove before everyone so that they may take warning. I charge you in the sight of God and Jesus Christ and the elect angels to keep these instructions without partiality and to do nothing out of favoritism. Well, listen, what Paul's saying here is this. If an elder is making a mistake, if an elder is caught in a sin, it should be brought to the leadership. But listen, it shouldn't just be one person. It ought to be corroborated and validated by at least two or three witnesses. And then Paul says, if that happens, you should address that publicly with that particular elder. And as you do that, then you know what? It protects the church from any harm from leaders who are caught in a sin and need to be corrected. And then Paul goes on to say in verse 22, another important passage, it regards laying on the hands. How many of you are here for the anointing with oil ceremony? Anybody here for that? Well, you know, the Bible talks about laying on of hands for a lot of different reasons. But somebody tell me one of the reasons we lay our hands on people. Healing, yeah. What's the scripture there? Lay your hands on the sick and they will recover. And that when people come down for healing, in my prayer line, you know, when I'm praying for people in the prayer line, you know, I always say, listen, we're going to agree together. I'm going to lay my hands on you, believing what God said. We'll lay our hands on the sick and they'll recover. But how many of you know that laying on of hands is also kind of an ordination ceremony, getting people for promotion and ready for ministry? And that's exactly what Paul's talking about here. In other words, laying hands on people to say, listen, we think you're ready to be promoted into a leadership position in this church. And that's exactly what he's talking about here. So let's read verse 22. Do not be hasty in the laying on of hands and do not share in the sins of others. Keep yourself pure. Now, let me just camp on that first part. Do not be hasty in the laying on of hands. In other words, Paul's saying, don't be quick to want to promote somebody to positions of leadership. That is something that you ought to take a lot of time and you ought to be very careful about. Don't just immediately, promote somebody by the laying on of hands. In other words, this is what we do around here. We should observe them for a while. We should watch their life. We should make sure they're mature. We should make sure that they have the fruit of the Holy Spirit in their lives before they're promoted. We need to make sure their walk lines up with their talk. We need to make sure, or let me just say this, just because someone, and we've seen this so many times, but just because someone has charisma doesn't mean they have the character to be promoted. Just because someone has gifts and talents of leadership doesn't mean they're ready to lay your hands on them to promote them into leadership. You see, you have to be very, very careful about who you promote into a position of leadership. And we're very careful about that here at Lakewood. Just three chapters over, Paul actually addresses this. And he says about the elders, again in a position of leadership, he said, an elder should not be a new disciple who would be vulnerable to living in the clouds of conceit and fall into pride and make him an easy target or easy prey for Satan. See, one of the dangers, and we've seen that here over the years, that 20 years I've been here, when you elevate somebody too quickly, when they don't have the weight or the substantial character to keep them in that position, very often what happens, you can get puffed up with pride. And when you get up puffed up with pride, pride goes before a what? It almost always happens that way. You know, if you're puffed up with pride, usually there's a correction. God makes a correction. And usually you fall or you stumble or something happens and, you know, you have to more or less be humbled by the situation you're in to learn not to have pride. But here's a practical application. Don't promote people until they've proven themselves. Don't promote people into leadership until they've proven themselves in by being observed for a long period of time. Number six. Now, I'm not going to get into this, but this, the context of this here, yeah, everybody's going to throw darts at me here, but don't throw darts at me. Let me give you the context here. Timothy apparently has something wrong with his digestion, and I don't know if you know that back but back then, the water is not pure like we have today. Very often, the water was contaminated, and Timothy may have had some kind of chronic intestinal disorder. I can't say diarrhea up here, but I just did, but no. But you know, he may have had some intestinal or stomach disorder. And wine in that day had small amounts of alcohol. And how many of you know that alcohol is a disinfectant? And when wine is fermented, very often that is much purer water and much less likely to be contaminated with bacteria. And so here's what people think. Some people think that that Timothy, because of the drunkenness of the society around them there in Ephesus, he had taken a vow that he was not going to drink any wine at all because he didn't want to let people be influenced by him doing that because they were coming out of a society and a culture that was very given to drunkenness. But all Paul is saying here is this. He just says this, stop drinking only water and use a little wine because of your stomach and your frequent illnesses. Basically, he's saying, use the medicine that you have available to treat your intestinal problem or what's going on in with your stomach or your digestion. Now, here's the point I want you to take away. Without arguing about alcohol, we're going to talk about this. How many of you know if God has provided something that's medicine and it can help us do what to treat what we have, how many of you know it's okay to take that medicine? Because, you know, a lot of times when I was growing up especially, a lot of people said, well, we're just going to either choose God or we're going to choose medicine. And you can't choose both. You have to choose one or the other. But I would just encourage you, one of the takeaways and the practical takeaways from this particular passage is that if there's medicine available to treat your particular problem and you can afford it or you have insurance, you know what, I would just encourage you, don't hesitate to take it. My dad used to say it like this. Joyce mentioned it this weekend. Remember at the tomb of Lazarus, what did Jesus tell the people to do? Roll away the stone and he'll call Lazarus out of the tomb. But see, we have to do our part. We have to roll away the stone. We have to take what we know to take. Take care of our bodies, but take care of medicine. But you know what? Whenever I'd prescribe medicine to people, I'd say, listen, don't believe in that medicine. Believe in God who can heal you through that medicine. But you know what? How many of you know God can do what medicine cannot do? But the encouragement I have just from this little passage here is if it's okay to take medicine. If you need medicine and it helps your situation, it's okay to take it. Amen? And then we're going to wrap this up. I knew this was going to be quick tonight, but we're going to wrap this up with one last point, and that has to do with good and evil deeds, and it's found in the last two scriptures here. The sins of some are obvious, reaching the place of judgment ahead of them, and the sins of others trail behind them. Now, some scholars think that he may be talking about the people that you were considering for promotion in ministry, meaning that sometimes their sins are obvious, but sometimes you don't find out about them till later. But I'm not even going to discuss that. I'm just going to talk about it about ourselves. How many of you know we can do things and people don't know what we're doing? They can be hidden and they cannot be obvious. But what Paul's saying here is that some sins are obvious. They go before you, go in the place of judgment ahead. But other sins trail behind us. In the same way, good deeds are obvious, and even those that are not obvious cannot remain hidden forever. Now, what does all that mean? I think it means that whatever we do, we sow seeds. And you know what? If we're sowing seeds to our flesh, and if we're sowing seeds to our sinful nature, you know, how many of you know there's going to be a harvest one day? And so if you continue to do that, you may not see the harvest immediately, but there will be a harvest. Now, let me give you an example of that. Funny story my dad used to tell. When he was a kid, my dad didn't necessarily like to work that hard, especially outside. And so they lived on a cotton farm. And I don't know if you've ever picked or planted cotton, but it is hard work and it's usually in the heat. And so they sent my dad out, my granddad sent my dad out with a sack of seeds, cotton seeds. And he said, John, I want you to go out to a field about this size and I want you to make the holes in the ground and I want you to plant the seeds and I want you to take care of this part of the field. Well, my dad got out there and it was very hot and he didn't want to sweat and get dirty and all that stuff. So my dad had an idea. He said, rather than me and go and make little holes and plant all over this field, he just went and dug a hole in one corner and dumped all the seeds in one area, thinking he could get away with this. Well, how many of you know it took about a month and my granddad went out there and there are no seeds where John was supposed to have planted it and all the seeds are in one corner. His sins found him out. And see, that's a silly story, a funny story, but listen, that's the way it is with the things of spiritual nature. When you sow to the flesh, you're going to reap from the flesh. But how many of you know when you sow to the Spirit, you're going to reap from the Spirit? So, and let me turn around. That's the negative. Let me turn around the positive. Everything you do for people, everything you do to sow to the Spirit rather than the flesh, every time you help people, every time you let somebody out in front of you in traffic, every time you buy somebody's lunch, every time you help out a widow, every time you do anything for God's people, listen, those are good seeds. And I love what it says here, the very last scripture. It says, in the same way, good deeds are obvious. Sometimes we see what you do, but other times we don't. But listen, even those that are not obvious cannot remain hidden forever. How many of you know one day God will reward you for everything that you've done? So here's my encouragement. Just seven areas of application tonight. Let's go back over them. Let's don't forget how to not forget to take care of the widows. Excuse me. First off, how to take care of everyone with utmost honor, respect, and kindness. Rebuke them. Don't rebuke them harshly, but rather encourage them and treat them with gentleness and kindness. Don't forget about widows. Don't forget about orphans. Don't forget about those that are foreigners. Give utmost honor to those people who are in leadership amongst you. If a leader fails, listen, quietly bring two or three people who can corroborate that and address it, and then let the church address that leader if need be. Don't be very careful in laying your hands on people. Don't promote people until they've proven themselves. It's okay to take medicine. That's the sixth one. And the seventh one is this. Our good deeds and our sins will eventually come to light. And thank God, most of our deeds are going to be good, and we're going to sow to our spiritual nature and not our sinful nature. Amen. If you receive that tonight, would you say amen? Amen. I'm going to ask. Come on up here. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Paul. Give Dr. Paul another big hand clap. That was an awesome teaching. Let's close out in prayer. Father, we thank you so much for tonight. We thank you always for the opportunity to gather together to learn your word. And we thank you, Lord, that the instructions that you gave us tonight in 1 Timothy 5 will go down deep in our heart. Lord, it'll renew our minds, and we're going to live that sort of life that models Jesus here in the earth. And we thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Awesome. Well, next week, we're going to have Pastor Lisa here. She's going to be teaching on chapter 6. So make sure next week that you come on out. But like I always say, come on out to Monday night Bible study, but make sure you also come out to the midweek service, come out to the weekend services. Make sure that you're here as often as you can be. Amen? Amen. All right, see you next week. We love you.